Timothy, for being here. We're very honored that you're here with us today. We just completed a distance education program with over 250 plus students from across Texas, from Bernie to Wichita Falls, the Fort Worth suburbs area. We had a great conversation with these students. It was very interesting to hear their questions and to interact with them so remotely. One of the things that they asked, and I think it's probably a very common question to ask any author, is what was your inspiration to write The Worst Hard Times?
Thank you for bringing me back here. It's great to be back. I'm going to finish that 72-ounce steak, which I've been working on for the last 6 years. I'm about a third of the way through it right now. And please, it's too much to call me as a very, very special guest. I'm just a writer and a storyteller, and I'm happy to be here because this was the fount of so many amazing stories from people who are still alive. And I was so lucky in that I did get to benefit from people who were living and could look me in the eyes and tell me this wonderful story. And one more compliment to Texas, and that's all I'm going to give you. Those questions from those kids today were damn good. I have been to colleges, I don't want to tell you how much they charge in tuition, where the questions weren't as good as the kids. Oh, weren't those fabulous, those early learning? They just asked great questions. Now, Guy, and thank you for hosting this. As to the question of inspiration, every writer looks for a story that hasn't been told. Every storyteller looks for an audience for their stories. I'm Irish-American, and storytelling is part of our DNA. And so it's just like, you know, hunger or music or something like that. It's an impulse. We have to tell stories. I realized when I was working on this several pieces about small towns for the New York Times that most of what Americans knew about the Dust Bowl wasn't the big story. They knew only the story that Steinbeck told about the Grapes of Wrath. And you know, that is the story of American history. You know this guy in so many cases. Somebody gets a first take at the episode. They tell it, and that becomes the accepted narrative. Everyone thinks that everyone in this region fled and went to California. And they think it's all about Okies and the Central Valley, and that's accepted wisdom. But the historical fact is that two-thirds of the people who lived at the five-state epicenter of America's worst, call it man-made disaster, never went anywhere. And so that was my inspiration, was just to ask a simple question. What was it like to live through days before Social Security, days when some people ate roadkill, days when some people had come and homesteaded this land and started out living in sod houses? And again, I'll stress this time and again, there are people with us today, probably in this room, who can remember that. These are not distant, lost bits of history. They're living still. So my inspiration was to tell a story that had not been sold. And then there was an urgency because people who lived through the Dust Bowl and are alive today were kids, little kids. At the most, they were teenagers because they're in their 90s now, 80s and 90s. And I felt that, like World War II vets who are dying at the rate of something like 5,000 a day, I really wanted to be able to get this sort of, the baton was being passed on to me. I wanted to get this story before these people passed.
The book does a wonderful job of summarizing the federal efforts. And we'll talk more about the federal efforts in a bit, but were there state and local efforts to address the Dust Bowl on an organized fashion? Did state officials travel? Did you find anything in the records indicating that they specifically tried to address either the causes or the conditions?
Yeah, that's a great question. Let me just back up for 1 minute and put through the larger history. What really brought settlement to this area, as most of you know, was this used to be ranching country. It was grass country. Bison lived on the grass. Indians pushed aside. Then it was cattle country. People came here because it was great grassland. You could raise cattle. But at the start of the 20th century, it was largely unpopulated. And I found the census of 1900, looking at the 12 counties in the Texas Panhandle and finding very few people living there. It was almost, as I called it, a tabula rasa. It was a blank slate. And so what happened was we wanted to encourage settlement in this part of the country that a government agent had said in 1820. The president had sent a surveyor out and he said, this part of the country is, quote, almost wholly uninhabitable by a people dependent on agriculture. It didn't say you couldn't ranch it, didn't say you couldn't run cattle on it, but it said by a people dependent on agriculture. Well, all that changed when we changed the Homestead Act. So they doubled the Homestead Act, which meant instead of getting, you know, a quarter mile, you could get a square mile. You could get a full mile. That was in 1900. The peak of American homesteading was 1914. Most people think it was the 1800s. It was not. And it was here. It was right here in the High Plains. So people who had never owned anything in their family's life, these were Germans who had lived in the Russian steppe in the Volga region. These were so-called poor white trash whose parents had fought on the Confederate side of the Civil War. These were Scots-Irish, the real fighting breed of folks who'd sort of been kicked around the country. These were Latinos who came from the South. They'd never owned anything. They finally had something. They had a square mile of dirt on this Texas panhandle, and they were very good years. Initially, they were good years. So the government had encouraged, just to go to the government role, the government had encouraged this by doubling the Homestead Act. And you could own a free square mile by just proving up your land. That's what caused the great initial influx of people, aided by the railroads as well. Now, when a disaster hit, starting in 1930 and going through most of the decade, it lent itself to this sort of decade-long thing. Most people think when you're in the middle of a disaster, it can't possibly last that long. But it was one of those things that just went on and on and on, and they had no history of it. When it initially hit, people didn't know what they were dealing with. They had no history. They had no institutional memory. Because the Indians had been pushed aside, they couldn't say, well, have you ever experienced anything like this before? And because most of the grassland had been turned upside down, as one half Apache, half Anglo, half cowboy, half Indian told me, his father told him the story of the Dust Bowl was simply wrong side up, like the grass itself had been turned over. When it happened, you had no institutional memory. You couldn't go to somebody and say, what, do your grandparents know about something like this? Can you give us help? So they did have local efforts initially, Guy. They did try rancher helping rancher, farmer helping farmer, but they didn't know what they were dealing with. It was unprecedented. They had nothing. The wind had always blown. You guys know this more than anyone. The wind always blows here. Droughts always a part of the panhandle. Droughts have been a part of the plains forever. What was different here was the grass wasn't in place. That was the only element that was missing, and that was what they didn't have. They didn't know what they were dealing with, so that's why eventually it became a federal response.
One of the characters in your book, or the one of the leading figures that's so important, is Big Hugh Bennett. A very interesting man. And FDR brings him on early into the New Deal. But Bennett goes into the Department of the Interior instead of the Department of Agriculture. Was there a debate within the administration about where to put this guy with his conservation ideas?
Yes, there was. And again, I'll back up for a second here. When this happened, Franklin Roosevelt, newly elected president, started his term in 1933. Prohibition had just ended. He went up to the Dakotas, Roosevelt did, and I'll never forget this. I saw this picture of a sign of a farmer in his overalls. He held up a sign that said, Mr. President, you gave us beer, now give us water. And Roosevelt turned to an aide, Interior Department aide, it was Harold Ickes, and he said, the beer was the easy part. And it really was. This was a terrible drought, and people thought the president, so, Roosevelt also felt, he started this Dust Bowl commission to look at the causes of the Dust Bowl. And they came back and they said they just hammered the land, that they shouldn't have ripped up all this good grass for dryland wheat. And people were starting to leave, the exodus was starting. And Roosevelt said, I'll be damned if I'm going to have a big part of the United States empty out on my watch. So he was determined to not let a big part of the United States basically become depopulated, having so recently been populated by the Great Homestead Search. So they tried a lot of things. But you're right about Hugh Bennett, that Hugh was this so-called doctor of dirt. You know, he had a PhD in soil science, and he bragged that he had camped on every state, on the dirt of every state in the United States, that he had slept on the ground of all 48 states. He could describe the dirt. There was no better person to turn to when Roosevelt needed someone. But Bennett was a very, you know, he could tell good stories. He was a farmer's kid. He could tell the farmer's daughter a joke. He really knew how to talk to the folks. But he also had a PhD, and he knew what he was talking about. And he would come to this part of the country and tell people the truth. He would say, you screwed up. And they didn't need to be told that. They knew that. A lot of them knew that. So Bennett was instrumental ultimately in founding the Soil Conservation Service. We can get into some detail, but there were different jurisdictional fights. One of the things that stood out to me, I remember they had these Dust Bowl summits in this region where they bring together different government people, they bring together different farmers, and they say, what can we do? What's the answer? A lot of things were thrown around. One of the ideas briefly considered was, and I'm not exaggerating, they considered giving the land back to the Indians. And the Indians said, are you crazy? What's your time?
The Secretary of the Interior, Harold Ickes, was known for his intelligence and wit. Do you have any examples of some of the things he would say in this situation and how he dealt with Henry Wallace, who was from Iowa?
Yeah, Ickes was, some call him a smart ass. He was a very strong Roosevelt aide, a very good diarist too, so he kept long memos. There was a struggle within the Roosevelt administration. It was a very simple and basic one. Do you try to restore the land and save the people, or do you give up on it? And there was tension within the administration. Early on, everybody was for restoration, do things. Remember, we had no such thing as food stamps. We had no farm price support, the great system now that keeps so many farmers wealthy for doing very little, in some cases doing something, but it's a huge system that's gone so far from what it originally was. This started under Ickes and Roosevelt. They would give a little bit of money. They would send agricultural agents out to shoot. It seems strange in a time when 25% of the people were out of work, to shoot cattle and slaughter pigs so that the price would go up. They called it forced scarcity. They thought if they killed, and I have some anecdotal stories where I told of little girls hiding in their basements because the government agents were out and they were going to slaughter their favorite cattle. But they tried so many different things. I talked about giving the land back to the Indians. That was one of the things proposed. One of the things that Roosevelt and Ickes did with the civilian, with the CCC, Civilian Conservation Corps, was they set out to plant trees. And they were going to plant, they ultimately planted 200 million trees. And you can see some of these trees still today, not far from here. It was going to be a giant shelter belt running from the Canadian border all the way down the midsection of the United States, a 100-mile corridor. And in between these trees, they thought you'd be able to farm because it would be sort of a windbreak. It sounds like a crazy idea, but it was Roosevelt's idea, and he stayed with it. And so they didn't know what kind of trees to plant initially. They tried different species. They had species brought in from the Sierra. They had some real knuckleheaded schemes for a while. But you'd have these CCC workers sleeping in tents, not unlike the one you have here in your museum, who get up bright and early, young boys from New York City or Michigan, and go out and start planting trees. And the folks in the region here liked it because A, it was a payroll. It meant there was money in their community. And B, it meant they were trying at least to do something.